for joining us for our second part of our gospel special. I'm Fakisha Kumbo, and we're going to continue with our guest today, Mr. Chapman Roberts, Ms. Sissy Houston, Reverend Timothy Wright, and Dr. Don Quinn Kelly. But first, Elba Marijo. I'm sorry, Elba Ramijo. Recently, CACE International caught the sizzling performance of Elba at a Sounds of Brazil concerts presentation at the Palladium. This lady gives a wild stage show, exotic clothes, unabashed sexuality, and fiery passion, which exemplifies the spirit of the rich and diverse culture of Brazil. Her show features 22 performers and lambada dancers and spans the musical styles and driving rhythms of her native northeastern Brazil. She tours Europe after America. Oba Oba 90, a Brazilian musical extravaganza, took Europe by storm, and it's doing the same in America. This annual review played Broadway's Marquee Theater. It's a scorching spectacular, pulsating with intensity and sensuality, which explores the historical music and dances of Brazil, dating from the liberation of the African slaves. It dances the samba and many more, including the increasingly popular lambada of Northeast Brazil. But the most thrilling and spectacular of all is the acrobatic capoeira dance, in which the dancers display an agility and precision that is absolutely breathtaking. Oba Oba comes around every year in Europe and America. Catch it if you can. A new gospel called Truly Blessed is at the Longacre Theater on Broadway now. It stars Esther Moore, and it's a story of our beloved Mahalia Jackson. How can we account for the popularity of gospel on Broadway? Mr. Roberts, you want to deal with that?
I'm not sure there is a popularity. You see, I was the musical director for Don't Bother Me, I Can't Cope, which introduced Alex Bradford on Broadway. I was the musical director for Bubbling Brown Sugar, which had a gospel segment in it. And then UB, which I arranged for UB in gospel music. And then For Your Arms Too Short to Box with God, which was in fact a gospel opera on Broadway. And even though we came three times, the last time with Patti LaBelle and Al Green, we never stayed for as long as a chorus line. We never stayed for as long as a Cats. We never stayed as long as an Evita. So that for us, a year on Broadway or 2 years on Broadway was considered a hit. Well, if that's a hit, then what is 8, 9, 10, 11 years, which is what the standard is for a large hit? So I don't think there really is a popularity. I think that it was overblown because there was more than one black show on Broadway out of 36. Oh. Very often the white actors would complain, there's so many black shows. I said, yes, both of them, because I was the music director for both. There are only two. So it's being perceived as being a lot, which is mean that's all you're gonna get.
Yeah.
So there is no popularity. I think that is a myth. The show is a very low budget show. I understand the budget is somewhere in the neighborhood of $750,000, when we know now the standard for a true Broadway show is around $8 or $10 million.
Wow. Okay.
So that no great risk has been taken because there is no popularity for gospel music. Now there's a reason for that. There's a thing called the box office, and no matter how good you are, no matter how talented you are, if the people don't come and sit in the seats and pay $40 to $50
yeah.
per person
yeah.
to come and see the production, then nobody can make
yeah,
money.
Yeah, because Gospel of Colonus didn't last very long.
Absolutely, because it's very, very expensive.
Yeah.
And the audience
yeah.
that it's built on to depend upon cannot really afford to pay those prices. I'm not saying the price should be brought down.
Mm.
I'm saying because then the actors have to be paid. I mean, this is what the market is now. This
okay.
is what's necessary for anything to happen. But to attract an audience that can pay that kind of money is extremely difficult. So it'll probably be a limited run. There is no popularity.
Do you have to broaden the scope of what you're doing with the gospel plays in
no.
order to attract a
No, I think that when you use a gospel as the medium, that you necessarily confine what the
okay.
possibilities are. There's only so far that you can take that, and there are certain subjects that cannot begin to be broached because it is gospel music, and because the integrity of the music must be maintained. So you do limit yourself, and therefore you limit an audience that might be interested in more things than what you're limited your discussion to.
Mr. Roberts, let me just, I know we could talk on that for the rest of the show, but we just kind of move on here. When I was a little girl, I mean little girl. I went to Prophet Jones Church in Detroit, which was a big theater, like, and I guess if I had to classify it, I would think it would be like Pentecostal type. I'm not really sure. But one thing I noticed, that the people were dancing. They were dancing in the aisles, they were dancing everywhere, as long as they didn't cross their legs. Now, much of gospel music is danceable these days. Wait a minute. What is this about dancing without crossing your legs? I mean, Dr. Kelly, you are our historian here.
It goes back to something called shout dancing in slavery. It wasn't shout dancing, it was called shout. It's not dancing. And it comes from West Africa, where if you cross your legs, it was considered secular or social. But if you didn't cross your legs, if you moved in a circle, you moved to a rhythm and moved your feet, it was a religious experience.
Rejoicing.
Right. It was the joy of the experience, but it was not dancing. And you find something similar if you were to look in Budun or Yoruba, Santeria, those other African presences in the rest of the Western Hemisphere, where you see people dancing in circles and movement in circles, they don't cross the feet.
And in biblical times, they had paid dancers. They had paid dances. If you read the Old Testament scriptures,
I think they have some now too.
There's one other interesting.
It's true.
Is that the spirit or is that you?
Right.
Is that, you know, gospel in terms of the 20th century does kind of get a big boost in the early years from the Pentecostal movement,
right.
And you used to have kind of a separation of the official service, then the post service or the pre service, where people would move to the music, because people weren't quite sure how to include music that you can move to in terms of the Eurocentric perspective that a lot of people had kind of adopted after the Civil War.
You know, also when I was a little girl, my mama says, I don't remember this, but there, the traveling quartets used to come around to the church, like the Five Blind Boys and the Mighty Clouds of Joy, and they would perform, and also there were what they call associations, which is really associations.
I was in the Quartet Association, yes.
Now, what I understand is that these associations would meet like 3 or 4 days, like in the country church, and you'd have all kind of booths and people selling food, and everybody was dressed up in their Sunday go-to-meeting clothes, and choirs would come and sing, just like you said you did. What is the future for this old-time religion music, this
That's
traditional?
That's alive and
well.
In some areas.
Right.
It's on a different level now.
Absolutely.
What they call them now, they call them workshops now.
That's exactly what they call them.
They call them workshops now.
And they charge.
It's not free anymore.
Like there's an entrance, initiation,
Initiation fee or whatever. But
it's necessary because times have changed. Things are much more expensive. You can't afford to give. You know, a lot of people would like to give up their talent more. You know what I'm saying? I give my way by serving my church, where they give you a stipend, not a pay. You know what I'm saying? It's not a pay that you get. It's an honorarium or whatever, you know what I'm saying? Which is good because I thank God I don't have to depend on that kind of thing. But there are people who, you know, they need, when you sing, they want.
That's right.
They need to survive.
It goes back to what we were talking about
on
Broadway.
Absolutely.
And if you want to get a lot of people together, you've got to rent a large space. It costs a lot of money.
It costs a lot of money. Hotels and whatever, ballrooms or whatever, where you have your facilities.
Well, we're going to take a break here and listen to some old-time gospel music from the ARC, or the Art Choir, who were performing at Pentecostal Church in Brooklyn called the House of the Lord Church. And this sister is getting down. And so we're going to lift him up. So let's take a look at that for a second.
I don't know where you come from.
have commercial gospel. Some people are calling contemporary gospel commercial gospel. What effect will that have on the heritage, the cultural heritage of gospel music?
I don't think it should have any.
I don't think it's going to hurt it. I think it'll help broaden.
It's all according to what you feel in here. That's what it all goes back to.
Sure.
I think what's inside of you.
And, oh, yeah.
Like the one is, BB and CeCe has a song out that I think is a tremendous song. Heaven is where I want to be.
Right.
Now, what is wrong with that?
Nothing.
It has to do with what we talked about the first part, about the transcendence nature of the music and the function of the of God in the music. You know,
I listen to it every morning.
The spiritual quality, that,
I think
that
it's
has
great.
Something to do with it.
What is the impact, Dr. Kelly, as a social historian, of gospel on the European American as well as the African American society?
I guess we, in terms of the European American society, it's that a Broadway play can't last 8 years. I mean, if you want to talk about it practically. The other side, I had to maybe pull the two together. It's clear that gospel as a phenomena is for the entire American culture, a symbol of transcendence. Whenever there's a need to, you know, Mahalia Jackson sang at John Kennedy's inauguration. You know, so, I mean, you know, there's obviously this role of transcendence that the music plays in terms of the entire culture. At the same time, one of the ironies of gospel music is one of the few